In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord. Almighty God, our Maker and Redeemer, we poor sinners confess unto thee that we are by nature sinful and unclean, and that we have sinned against thee by thought, word, and deed. Wherefore we flee for refuge to thine infinite mercy, seeking and imploring thy grace for the sake of our Lord Jesus Christ. O most merciful God, who hast given thine only begotten Son to die for us, have mercy upon us, and for his sake grant us remission of all our sins, and by thy Holy Spirit increase in us true knowledge of thee, and of thy will, and true obedience to thy word, to the end that by thy grace we may come to everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our heavenly Father, hath had mercy upon us, and hath given his only Son to die for us, and he, and for his sake, forgiveth us all our sins. To them that believe on his name, he giveth power to become sons of God, and hath promised them his Holy Spirit. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. Grant this, Lord, unto us all. Give ear, O Lord, to my prayer.
Listen to my plea for grace.
Teach me your way, O Lord, that I may walk in your truth. I give thanks to you, O Lord, my God, with my whole heart.
And I will glorify your name forever.
For great is your steadfast love toward me.
You have delivered my soul from the depths of
Sheol. O God, insolent men have risen up against me. A band of ruthless men seek my life.
And they do not set you before them.
But you, O Lord, our God, merciful and gracious.
Slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Give ear, O Lord, to my prayer. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God, so rule and govern our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, that ever mindful of your final judgment, we may be stirred up to holiness of living here and dwell with you in perfect joy hereafter. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The Old Testament for the eighth Sunday after Pentecost is taken from Isaiah chapter 44. Thus says the Lord, the King of Israel, and is redeemed, the Lord of hosts. I am the first, and I am the last. Besides me, there is no God. Who is like me? Let him proclaim it. Let him declare and set it before me, since I appointed an ancient people. Let them declare what is to come and what will happen. Fear not, nor be afraid. Have I not told you from of old and declared it? And you are my witnesses. Is there a God besides me? There is no rock. I know not any. This is the word of the Lord. The epistle is taken from Romans chapter 8. For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed to us. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the sons of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it in hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to decay and obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation has been groaning together in the pains of childbirth until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies. For in this hope we were saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope, for who hopes for what he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know what to pray for as we ought, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. And he who searches hearts knows what is in the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. Here endeth the epistle. Oh, the depth of the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God.
How unsearchable are his judgments, and how inscrutable his ways.
For from him and through him and to him are all things.
To him be glory forever. Amen.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 13th chapter. Jesus put another parable before them, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a man who sowed good seed in his field. But while his men were sleeping, his enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat and went away. So when the plants came up and bore grain, then the weeds appeared also. And the servants of the master of the house came and said to him, 'Master, did you not sow good seed in your field? How then does it have weeds?' He said to them, 'An enemy has done this.'
So the servants said to him, "Then do you want us to go and gather them?" But he said, "No, lest in gathering the weeds you root up the wheat along with them. Let both grow together until the harvest, and at harvest time I will tell the reapers, 'Gather the weeds first and bind them in bundles to be burned, but gather the wheat into my barn.'" Then he left the crowds and went into the house, and his disciples came to him, saying, "Explain to us the parable of the weeds of the field." He answered, "The one who sows the good seed is the Son of Man, the field is the world, and the good seed is the children of the kingdom. The weeds are the sons of the evil one, and the enemy who sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the close of the age, and the reapers are angels. Just as the weeds are gathered and burned with fire, so will it be at the close of the age. The Son of Man will send his angels, and they will gather out of his kingdom all causes of sin and all lawbreakers, and throw them into the fiery furnace. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. He who has ears, let him hear." Here endeth the gospel.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And the children may come forward for the children's choir. Thank you.
the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen. Over the last couple of months, we have been speaking about that spiritual reality of the war that rages between the kingdom of God and the kingdom of the world. And we have noted that these battle lines run through the world, the church, every family, and every human heart. We have had the chance to focus on three of those four, and today, God the Holy Spirit, through the words of our Lord Jesus, invites us to focus on the battle that rages within the visible manifestation of God's kingdom on earth, namely, the Holy Christian Church. And so it is that last week we heard about a sower who is none other than Christ himself, who recklessly, if you recall, sowed the good seed in his field, the seed that was nothing else other than the precious word, the gospel, that Christ has died for your sins, that you were forgiven for his sake, that seed was sown into the hearts of men, that they might have life and that they might have it abundantly. And today we hear about another sower, and he is not a very good sower at all. In fact, he is the enemy of the good sower, and he does not sow the precious seed of the word of God, but instead he sneaks in and does where he does not belong, and he sows weeds among the wheat. And let us note, then, as we move to this new parable, that our metaphor has shifted a little bit. The good sower is the same. He is the Son of Man. He is our Lord Jesus Christ. But last week, we were focused on the soil, and the soil was the hearts of men. This week, we are not speaking about the soil, but we are speaking about the field. And the field is that field which ultimately belongs to the good sower. That field is the world in which he sows lavishly his good seed, which is the Holy Gospel. And the wheat is the fruit of that word of God. It is each and every individual Christian who has sprouted up to life on account of the work of the Holy Spirit in their hearts. The wheat is the sons of the kingdom of God. And the wicked sower, then, is the adversary. He is the devil, who is always at work to try to destroy all the good that God does. And so, since the beginning, throughout the ages, there has always been two sowers sowing their seed. One sowing the seed of the word of God unto life, and the other sowing lies unto death. And note how the evil sower operates. Where the good sower sowed good seed in his field, there precisely is where the wicked sower sneaks in to sow weeds among the wheat. The Holy Christian Church, that communion, that body made up of all the sons of the kingdom scattered throughout the world, is the visible manifestation of God's kingdom on earth. They are the people of God, of whom God says, "You yourselves, like living stones, are being built up as a spiritual house, to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ." They are the people of whom God says, "You are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for my own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light." And so the wicked sower freely and liberally sows his seed, but where does he seek to sow it precisely? Most of all, he desires to sneak into the church and sow the weeds among the wheat. And by slipping in false brothers among the true Christians, the devil wishes to bring great shame upon the church. By gross outward sin, he desires to keep the light from shining, or at least to obscure it. And we've all heard those accusations, right? The accusations of hypocrisy. Often they are false, but all too often they are true. Those sins of Christians that all those outside the church can point to try and justify their rejection of the church and their rejection of her gospel message. It is in the church that the devil is most eager to sow his seed, because wherever there are souls being rescued from death by the preaching of Christ, wherever there are souls being brought to peace with God, there is the devil trying to destroy it. Wherever Christ sows his good seed, there will Satan be sowing his evil seed. Now we must remember that the church is both hidden and revealed. It is both visible and invisible. The hidden church are those throughout the entire world, in every denomination and in every congregation, who are united by faith with Christ, their head. All members of the hidden church are without spot or wrinkle or any such thing. They are holy and without blemish before God. But if we, of course, we realize on this side of glory, this side of the resurrection and judgment, we are holy and we are perfect only by grace, only by the forgiveness of sins won for us by the all-atoning sacrifice of Jesus. Yes, we are born again. Yes, we have a new heart. Yes, we are no longer slaves to sin, but the seed of sin still remains. So even now, the struggle continues. Even if membership in the hidden, invisible church directly corresponded to the visible church, she would not be perfect and sinless in this age. Even then, if we were to look to her perfection of life as the test, we'd see too many weeds, or at least too many that look like weeds, and turn away from the church and her message. But membership in the invisible church does not directly correspond with the visible. The devil sneaks in and sows his seeds, he sows his weeds, precisely where the word of God is sowed. Indeed, we all know it to be true that there are those who bear the name Christian, who are visibly part of a Christian congregation, who are not the wheat, who are Christians only outwardly or in appearance. And of course, the opposite is also true. There are those who are in a church that is heterodox, but are nonetheless truly the wheat and truly Christian. And so it is that from age to age, even within the church, the two sowers have sown. The wheat and the weeds have grown up together. In Adam's church, in the beginning, even after he received the gospel promise and believed, there was Cain, the murderer of his brother. In Abraham's church, there was Ishmael, the despiser of religion. In Isaac's, there was Esau, who sold his birthright and the gospel promise for a bowl of soup. In Jacob's, the 10 godless sons who sold their brother into slavery. On and on throughout the ages, shame was brought upon the holy people of God and their gospel message. And it is also the case, of course, even among those congregations planted by the apostles themselves. The weeds grew with the wheat. Just think of Corinth, right? Planted by the Apostle Paul, there were quarrels and schisms and factions and even incest. Now is this to say that pastors and Christian congregations should do nothing to check the growth of weeds within the Christian church? To let sin run rampant and unchecked? Or to quote St. Paul, are we to continue in sin that grace may abound? By no means, of course not. The field is the world, not the church specifically. Recall that from the parable. Often this is confused. The field is the world, not the church specifically. And so when the servants ask, do you want us to go and gather them? The master responds, no. Lest in gathering the weeds, you root up the wheat along with them, let both grow together until the harvest. He is not speaking against church discipline, which of course he cannot be, because Christ and the apostles commanded. Just a little later in Matthew's gospel, Jesus tells the disciples, whoever does not hear the admonition of the congregation, let him be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector. And Paul casts that incestuous man out of the Corinthian congregation. The field is the world. And so Jesus is not forbidding church discipline, but rather he is forbidding jihad. It is not for the church to go out into the world with the sword and force the wheat into the barn or to burn the weeds. Final judgment does not belong to the church, but it belongs to God. He alone reads hearts. The church is hidden and the church is revealed. It is both. And so it is that the wheat is not yet perfected. So it very well might be the case that you mistake the wheat for a weed. Or, on the other hand, the pagan can outwardly live a decent life and might be mistaken for the wheat. Indeed, church discipline is not forbidden and watchfulness is exhorted. The enemy in the parable slips in while the men are sleeping, right? When the pastors, those who are entrusted with the field, are not doing their job, are not being watchful. Those who are outwardly and publicly unrepentant are to be excluded from the Christian congregation. And on the other side, those who are repentant are to be forgiven. But this does not negate the fact that as long as the church has existed, and as long as she will exist, there will be weeds among the wheat. And there will be people who look more to the church's life than to her doctrine. These people maintain that if the church wants to be the church of God, she must be absolutely pure. Every member must be devout, born again, pious, and holy. And all its people must live in perfect harmony. And those looking for such a church will not find this in the true church. Because until the end of the age, the wheat and the weeds will grow up together. And because they do not find this in the true church, they will reject her altogether or join a false church, which does better at pretending that they have holier lives. Which, of course, is precisely why the devil comes and sows this weeds among the wheat, to keep people out of the church and to drive those who are in it out. But those who look to the church's piety or apparent holiness or virtue as a litmus test for authenticity are missing one very key and one very important fact, that the church is the church by grace. The people of God are the people of God by his call in the gospel, by the seed of his word planted in their hearts, that he sanctified them, having cleansed them by the washing of water with the word, so that he might present them to himself in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that they might be holy and without blemish. That he gives his body and his blood to be eaten and to be drank for the forgiveness of sins. The marks of the true church are not first and foremost holiness of life, but they are the marks of the cross, where Jesus died for the forgiveness of sin. They are the marks of the cross which are found in the pure preaching of the gospel and in the proper administration of the sacraments according to Christ's institution. The church is recognized by her absolution and by her preaching, by her baptism and by her supper. So do not let yourself be scandalized or driven away or deceived by the sins of those who bear the name Christian in appearance only, or even those who truly are the wheat, but look a little too much like weeds until before the day of judgment. The foundation of our faith is not on them, but it is in the seed of the sower, which is objectively preached to us, sown into us in our baptism, nourished by body and blood, and planted into our hearts. The seed which says, "Your sins are forgiven for Christ's sake." Amen. The ushers may come forward to receive the offering.
Let us pray for the whole Church of God and all people according to their needs. Redeemer and Lord of hosts, the future is in your hands. Remove all fear from us and keep us mindful that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed in us. Lord, in your mercy. Lord of heaven and earth, we give thanks that your Son, Jesus Christ, died to redeem the world and restore creation. Until new life supplants the groanings of this age, lead us to steward your creation well, not in waste, but in wise and diligent use, with thanksgiving. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, pour out the blessings of your Holy Spirit on the delegates who will assemble in convention in this week. Give wisdom to those who propose, deliberate, and decide to work and for the welfare of our synod. Guard all who speak and all who listen. Give us courage to do with integrity what we promise. Bless our plans and actions and grant success. Only let our manner of life be worthy of the gospel of Christ. Lord, in your mercy. We give you thanks for all who serve as instruments of your compassion. Those who care for the elderly at home and those who work in retirement and nursing facilities. Grant that they may serve as your hands, feet, and voice to give comfort and company to the lonely. Lord, in your mercy. O Lord, you are slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. Be patient with those who do not repent or believe. Send your Holy Spirit to bring them into saving faith. Lord, in your mercy, guide the leaders of all nations that they would work for peace and justice in the face of conflict and discord. By or despite their efforts, protect the weak and defenseless. Guard also those who served in our armed forces that they might be protected as well and also might protect the weak and defenseless, especially Sean, Austin, Thomas, and Leah. Lord, in your mercy. We commend to you all who endure the bondage of the fall through infirmity and weakness, especially Amy, Harold, Pat, Carol, Jordan, Aubrey, Barbara, Charlotte, Maya, Wanda, Kenny, and Patricia. Deliver them according to your will and strength and preserve their faith, that they may rejoice that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed in us. Lord, in your mercy. Lord God, you have called us according to your purpose. You cause all things to work together for our good. Keep us safe until that day when you will gather us with the saints into your kingdom, which has no end. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Blessed Lord, who has caused all holy scriptures to be written for our learning, grant that we may in such wise hear them, read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest them, that by patience and comfort of thy holy word, we may embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of everlasting life, which thou hast given us in our Savior Jesus Christ, who liveth and reigneth with thee in the Holy Ghost, ever one God, world without end. Amen. The Lord bless thee and keep thee. The Lord make his face shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. Amen. Good morning, and thank you for being in the Lord's house today, the eighth Sunday after Pentecost. Glad to see you all here. A couple of announcements. Today is St. Thomas's Ice Cream Social and Bake Sale at 4 to 7, so please go and join them for that and support them. Pies are available to be picked up, I believe, and they are going to be serving Coney dogs. And I think today is National Hot Dog Day, if I'm not mistaken. So in order to celebrate that properly, you should go over to St. Thomas today at 4 to join them for their ice cream social. This last Ladies' Aid, we were privileged to have Maya and her mother Rebecca come and share with us a little bit about their journey and her various medical difficulties and how God has supported them in all that time. So we thank them for coming out, and it was a blessing certainly to all of us who were there and got to hear that and got to see how cool it was for her to meet the unicorn Clover. I've never met a unicorn, so I'm a little jealous myself. And there's a little summary written up in the bulletin for those who missed it, just to kind of get a sense of what we talked about. Finally, two things that are not in the bulletin. Foundations of the Faith class, like I have been announcing, will be starting up somewhat soon. I'm thinking mid to late August, so if you are one of those people who is interested in taking that after service, please let me know when you're available so I can try to schedule it when we can get everyone together, preferably. So please talk to me about that soon. And then finally, the first week of August, my wife will be taking Annalise and Katarina out to California for the week. I will be staying back with the baby. It just sounded very unpleasant to take a five-month-old across the country. And so that's why I'm staying back here. And I'm also going to be out in California briefly in October doing a wedding for an old college friend who I made convert to Lutheranism, him and his wife, for me to do the wedding. And so now they're going to a Lutheran church, and that's great. They are out of town that week. And so I will be taking 1 week of vacation that first week in August. I will be around, so if there's any emergencies, please don't hesitate to call. But otherwise, I will be spending lots of time with the baby that week. And we'll be on vacation. We have someone from the seminary filling in that Sunday, but I will be there for the Shum family reunion to participate in that after the service. But I just didn't want to write a sermon and Bible study and do all that stuff while taking care of a little one, because it would be more difficult than otherwise. So I will be taking easy that week. Okay, I think that is all the announcements for this morning. Any vital announcements that I have left out? Okay, depart in peace.